Hate is plentiful here in a world where too often too many of us believe that a life committed to anger and rage will somehow hurt less than a life disciplined by the inclusion and love for all. For Louisa is 9 years old today. She loves her mother's smile and her father's laugh. She wishes she could hear them, see them, touch them. 5. Near the border, an old Yaqui man carries jugs of water in the back of his pickup truck. He loves who he is. 6. Private prisons in Arizona produce hundreds of millions of dollars in profit each year. They are owned by CCA, Corrections Corporation of America. More inmates equals more profit. Jan Brewer signs SB 1070 into law, not in support of safe borders, but in support of CCA stockholders. 7. At the protest, helicopter blades cut wind into chunks. On the ground, there are children with orange butterfly wings tied to their backs chanting, "Obama, listen, we want our parents back. Obama, listen, we want our parents back. Obama, listen." Luisa's smile is a sunrise. 8. Joe Arpaio increases raids to catch publicity. Deportations are carried out at schools, hospitals, food banks. 9. 9 students chain themselves to the Capitol doors. They're there for their fathers, for their mothers. They love who they are. 10. Near 7th and Southern Avenues in Phoenix, a gunshot is heard. A man named Thomas Kelly tells his neighbor, Juan Berela, to go back to Mexico or die before murdering him in front of his family. Juan Berela was a third-generation American. He is survived by his wife and 14-year-old daughter. 9. Luisa is 9 years old today. 8. Students chant, "Walk out, walk out," and hallways flood in Phoenix High Schools. Thousands spill into the street in protest for their fathers, for their mothers. They love who they are. The news will still call them lazy. 7. Near the border, the old Yaqui man carries a jug of water and leaves it beneath a tree where last June he found a girl dying. Her jaw was broken. She had been raped. She was 14 years old. 6. At first, all we see is the dirt on their hands before imagining the dreams they carried across borders. Now just see their hands folded in thirsty prayer, sinking slowly into sandbox graves unmarked and in the thousands. 5. Near the border, Minutemen cut jugs of water open with their knives. The water spills like a dream, seeps into the hot dust, and is gone as swift as a child's soul can leave its body. 4. Luisa's father is a carpenter named Jose, and the sheriffs in Phoenix walk like Roman soldiers. Little Luisa believes that Jesus is an Americano with beautiful blue eyes, perfect blue eyes. 3. No one knows what Christ looked like, and chances were he was not blonde and blue-eyed. 2. Today, Jesus could be anywhere. Today, Luisa prays hard and tries not to cry. The water spills from her cheeks like rain down a windshield. She tightens every muscle in her little body, and she prays hard for her parents to come back. She prays to Obama, she prays to the big God, she prays to Jesus Christ, but she does not pray in Spanish. No, not anymore. She is sure now God only answers in English. 1 9-year-old answers a reporter's question. She is love, she is brave. I don't think Jesus would deport anyone, she says, especially my mom and my dad.
I'm gonna do one more quick poem. Thank you for having me here. I wish I could hang out with all of you, but luckily and fortunately, I'm going to teach some kids from group homes who have this big presentation today, and it's gonna be awesome. So. This poem is about a different sort of program I put on, I guess. Okay.
It is not uncommon in my line of work to witness a child shake as they read a poem for the first time inside of a classroom. But yesterday, I was not inside of a classroom. Yesterday, I was at a federal prison on the yard where self-proclaimed paisas, peckerwoods, and crips conduct business against the backdrop of razor wire fences. On this particular occasion, inmates listened as 16 of the 35 men I taught in poetry workshops the previous week spilled their stories onto a single microphone. And the last to read is a man named C. His legs shake, his neck scar, glamorous enough to be featured on TV during a special about gangs. Content designed to keep suburban viewers amazed as if the corporations they work for ain't on some gangster shit, please. C's bullet wounds dip like fingers into wet sand against his body. I stand behind this man and watch as he is the last to read, the shyest light in my classroom of convicts, where the eyes of these men follow me as I write on the board each day, a dim glow trapped in their gazes, concealing all the caged memories of their childhoods, where the majority of them were raised to believe that they were mistakes. And a few bad choices along the way landed them in this place. Seems like their whole lives been misshaped somehow. C's legs shake with purpose, nervous as he speaks about his life. He is deathly afraid of what we're all afraid of, exposing ourselves in front of a set of eyes that just might redefine us with their judgment, explaining ourselves to a room of people who may not listen, who may not understand, who just might dismiss our humanity by labeling us bad or no good, or bad and no good, or black or dangerous, or black and dangerous, or poor, or less, or less, or less than, or disposable like a body in Ferguson, Missouri. If only you could see all of our reflections trapped in the tremble rushing through C's veins as each word tumbles out of his mouth like gas canisters filled with tulips, like hollowed out grenades filled with lilacs, thumping through the eardrums of 1,000 inmates standing on the yard, standing and listening. Yeah, listening. An audience as warm as any room of humans willing to love.
That was quite a way to start, wasn't it? That first one just really got to me. Just pray, you know, praying to Jesus for your mom to come back. This really matters, you know, what we're going to talk about this morning and what he said. Okay. I should have just gone outside and waited to come in until after Myrlin did his thing. Yeah. I love all of you. Whoever said that too, I love. The context that we come together in this year is economic justice in 2015. It is on everyone's mind, or it should be. Inequality is in the national and global dialogue like it's never been in my lifetime. And some links are being made, you know. One of the first calls to action post-Ferguson, no indictment, was Blackout Black Friday. I don't buy from big box stores the day after Thanksgiving. And I thought, when I saw that for the first time, I thought, God, 95% of Americans are not going to know what that link is between those two things. But I was so appreciative that the organizers did, this convergence of understanding that we are, by supporting the dominant corporate system right now, we are maintaining a system of inequality. You saw the same thing after the People's Climate March back in the fall last year in New York, when people came together to walk for climate change. People said, not just we need a new set of regulations, but the underlying economic system is what we are protesting. I was with a group of leaders who have for a long time, at a leading foundation nationally, not that long ago, and in the room were many of the leaders who've been in the fight for workers' rights, and some of them said, for a long time, we thought in some ways maybe it was good when we'd see something like consolidation in retail because there are fewer collective bargaining partners to sit with. But we are now seeing that so what? We have $15 an hour? Yes, that matters. But we get $15 an hour jobs at McDonald's? It's still a really crappy life. We actually need a different economy, and we need to join together with those who are building new economic models. That is what I'm seeing right now, is the potential and power for the convergence of movements, of people recognizing that it's really about community control of our futures versus corporate control of our futures. It's money versus life. It's the things that my dear friend David Korten has been saying for a very long time as an author and as a leader. I said the first day, No, it was the day before yesterday. I said that there was this big study done by the International Labor Organization that looked at 71 countries, and recently, it came out last year, they looked at 71 countries and what have been the most significant causes of wage inequality over the last several decades. So they looked at the offshoring of jobs through globalization, they looked at technologies that were displacing workers. They looked at the suppression of minimum wages and many other things, and they found that the number one corollary was how much what they called financialization was happening in that economy, how much, they also called it, Wall Street activity was happening in that economy. That's the number one contributor to wage inequality in societies over the last several decades in 71 countries. We see other paths. Quebec, for instance, Quebec used 30 years ago, they're a nice little case study for us, 30 years ago Quebec took their pension funds out of Wall Street and started to invest them in small to mid-sized businesses in their province, and they have identified that they have created 87,000 jobs over that time just in their province and kept 82,000 from moving away just by doing that. And they said, even if it was not corrupting politics and some other things, you know, as if that wasn't enough, but that they're actually, by taking their money out of Wall Street and putting it in their own community, they're keeping so many more jobs there. And some of our friends from Reading, Pennsylvania, one of the four poorest cities in the nation, came to the BALLE conference a couple years ago, and they said, to quote, part of it is understanding that in a globalized economy, we have to relocalize as much as possible to keep money circulating here. The first step is understanding that the status quo does not work. We've done everything you can here in Reading from a conventional economic development standpoint. We had all those fancy financial instruments right before everything collapsed in the stock market and we lost our shirts. So I think that there's a huge opportunity right now for all of us to come together, those who've been organizing for political power, those who've been building new economic models, those who've been in the fight for economic justice, for environmental justice, to recognize that it's money or life, you know? Are we all going to be okay? Do we recognize that everyone matters? I'm sorry, Myrlin is still getting to me. I'm just going to invite up David Korten. But this is a very important thing you're going to talk about. David, where are you? There you are. So David was one of the founding BALLE board members 14 years ago, and he's been a continuous touchstone for me over the years. When I get confused, I call David and have a little Skype with him, and he gets my mind straight. I'll say maybe more about you after you come up, David, but come on up.
Well, thank you, Michelle. Wow. I wanted to be sure they had the lights up in the room here so that we could see each other. the glare is blinding. Anyhow, hello, good BALLE buddies. I am so thrilled to be back here with you again. and particularly honored to be joining Michelle, Adrienne Marie Brown, and Van Jones, three of the great social movement leaders of our time, for this path-breaking session, Better Together, a Convergence of Social Movements. I'm also thrilled that BALLE has invited me to launch the 20th anniversary edition of When Corporations Rule the World at this conference, and I hope you'll join us for the lunch and workshop session at 12:45 in Salon 5 in the hotel. Get there early, and there will be boxed lunches available there. Now, our program notes for this conference note that Business Week called BALLE the Davos of Wall Street. It's a characterization perhaps more apt than Business Week may recognize. My remarks this morning will take a deep dive into the profound significance of BALLE as a counter to the devastation wrought by the Davos of Wall Street. The context of our work here, our work to build a global system of local living economies, is an epic struggle between money and life for the soul and fate of humanity and our living Earth Mother. Davos and the Wall Street economy stand with money and the exploitation and destruction of life to make money for those who already have money far beyond any need or beneficial use. At the time of BALLE's founding, an astute colleague called the Wall Street economy the suicide economy, destroying the foundations both of its own existence as well as the existence of humanity. Michelle spoke of the process of financialization. Remember, we used to talk about financial services? There was a recent, I think it was a McKinsey study, that was bemoaning the fact that though for a while, the percentage of GDP that went to financial services had been growing steadily, and that had sort of slacked off. It really raised the question, what do we mean by financial services? Basically, financial services should be treated as a cost center, not a profit center. Anyhow, BALLE and the Main Street economy stand with life. We seek a living economy that works in co-productive partnership with living Earth to meet the livelihood needs of all. Our work, BALLE's work, humanity's work, is to resist corporate rule, to liberate ourselves from servitude to Wall Street corporations and financial markets, and to live into being a planetary system of community-based local living economies that work for all. Truly work for all. We best understand the deep and epic significance of our work by placing it in a historical context. We are in an endgame struggle in a 5,000-year era defined by the rise and fall of imperial civilizations, in which the few gain monopoly control of the means of living of all to reduce the many to lives of oppression and involuntary servitude. There is a persistent and familiar pattern in this rise and fall of empire. The condition of the many becomes increasingly intolerable. The social fabric disintegrates. Violence becomes extreme and pervasive. The social and economic and ecological fabric disintegrate, and the society and its supporting biosystems collapse into chaotic disorder. This has repeated constantly over the last 5,000 years. It is now, however, different. For the first time in empire, in the human experience, empire's institutional reach is global and increasingly operates autonomously beyond the control of any human person or persons, and is on a path to colonize all the world's people and resources with the support of our failed money-saturated politics. As we meet President Obama and the U.S. Congress, Republicans and Democrats together join in common cause to finalize an international corporate rights agreement called the Trans-Pacific Partnership that will further consolidate corporate rule at the expense of democracy, people, and the rest of nature. This agreement, as many of you know, will literally make it illegal to favor local businesses. We'll say more about that after my presentation. Meanwhile, the social, environmental, and governance collapse that is now unfolding around us is potentially total and final. We, the people of living Earth, face a unifying imperative. The ability of the few to rule the many has always depended on keeping the many divided against one another by race, gender, religion, language, ethnicity, while privileging the demographic of the rulers. The privileged demographic in our country, the United States, has been and largely remains white male Protestants of British descent. Well, I grew up a white American middle class male Protestant of British and a bit of German descent. I bought the standard story. According to that story, the story I knew as a child, America was born of a democracy and a rebellion against tyranny. We created a land of limitless opportunity for all, became a global champion of freedom and democracy, a liberator of the oppressed, and the world's beacon of hope and possibility. But later, as an adult, I lived for 21 years in Africa, Asia, and Latin America. On a white American's mission to end global poverty by making them more like us. During those years, I witnessed the use of foreign aid to advance a global colonization of the world's people, resource, and resources by corporations and financial markets in a process led by the United States of America. Take the Green Revolution. It promised to make small farmers richer and more productive. In its application, however, chemicals destroyed the health and fertility of the soils and the health of farmers and their families. Debt and a bad year resulted in farmers losing their land. The beneficiaries were seed and chemical corporations and lenders who financed the inputs and then took over the foreclosed farmlands. Eventually, this experience opened my eyes to the American reality that Native Americans and African Americans have long known and never forgotten. America, my country, our country, is a nation born of empire forged from lands expropriated by force and deception from Native Americans and worked by African American slaves. Roughly a sixth of the land area of the continental United States is land expropriated from Mexico in the Mexican-American War. As the United States of America extended the boundaries of its imperial domain to the Pacific Ocean, we reached out beyond the great waters through missionaries, the U.S. military, and U.S. corporations to colonize the minds and resources of people far beyond our own borders. And we declared our dominion over the whole of Latin America. Over time, our colonizing corporations became transnational. They shed their pretense of national identity and loyalty, except, of course, when calling on U.S. military and diplomatic power to advance their interests and on U.S. taxpayers to subsidize their global operations. Then they joined an alliance with transnational corporations from Europe and Asia to establish an autonomous system of global corporate rule enforced by the World Trade Organization, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and international corporate rights agreements like NAFTA and the Trans-Pacific Partnership. It is difficult for those of us the system favors to see the truth, because the benefits of systemic privilege in an imperial society are so substantial for those it serves. Those of us who enjoy that privilege too easily accept and perpetuate the deceptions rather than risk banishment to the ghettos of the excluded. We are now, however, in a moment of awakening, a moment nationally and globally. The middle class is shrinking, living wage jobs are disappearing, students even from privileged backgrounds find the price of a college education is a lifetime of debt slavery. And the living systems of living earth are collapsing under our very feet. Even those of us once privileged can no longer deny the reality. Hope for us all lies in the more positive side of America's history. The historical struggles of our excluded for liberty, dignity, and democracy. The people of our imperial nation have been at the forefront of global worker, gender, civil rights, peace, and environmental movements. Each of these movements has made impressive victories. These victories, however, rather gains, hardly victories. These gains, however, remain partial for so long as the institutional structures of imperial corporate rule remain in place. And those structures will remain in place for so long as our progressive movements remain divided. I sense that we have arrived at a breakthrough moment of shared recognition of the imperative to act in common cause to confront and replace the institutions of corporate rule that drive imperial wars, injustice, involuntary servitude, and systemic destruction of Earth's capacity to support life. The current convergence of social movements is born of a growing recognition that the solution to a violent, corrupt, unjust, and ultimately self-destructive system is not reform. It is a new system. BALLE is at the forefront of defining and building that new system from the bottom up. That is why BALLE's role as the Davos of Main Street is at the leading edge of the creation of an ecological civilization that works for all. The living economy we commit ourselves to bring forth seeks three inseparable outcomes. The first is Earth balance. We are reawakening to what our ancestors knew and indigenous people still know. We humans are living beings, born of and nurtured by a living earth, itself born of a living universe. Earth does not belong to us. We belong to her. Our health and well-being depend on her health and well-being. We are relearning in ways appropriate to our time to live in a balanced, co-productive partnership with the whole of living Earth's community of life. The second outcome is equitable sharing. The essentials of life that living Earth gifts to us are both a common heritage and a common product of the living beings, all the living beings that together create and maintain them. We humans must learn to share with one another and with all of life's living beings the bounty that we create together. The third outcome is economic democracy. There is no political democracy unless ownership of the land, water, energy, homes, places of work, technology, and information on which we each and all depend for our daily living is equitably held by mature and responsible living people who have a strong interest in and commitment to the living community of place, the place on earth where they live and on which they depend for their sustenance. These three outcomes are in each instance exact opposites of those generated by the cultural and institutional system of the Wall Street suicide economy. Each is essential to a viable and prosperous human future. Without Earth balance, we expire. Without equitable sharing, we remain divided between the profligate and the desperate, and we lose our ability to function as coherent living communities. Without economic democracy, we continue to live in servitude to money-seeking corporations that value life only for its market price. United we live, Divided, we perish. We are the ones we've been waiting for. Thank you. Thank you. Now, thank you. Appreciate that. I want to add in here a very important message from David Levine, who's in our midst, and from the American Sustainable Business Council. This very afternoon, in 2 hours, the U.S. Congress will vote on fast track for the TPP. This is the agreement that, if it moves forward, can outlaw giving preference to local and national businesses, among its many other sins. It will facilitate further outsourcing of jobs, and it is not to help the people of other countries. It is to extend and strengthen corporate rule. So this is a crucial moment. Following this session, when we go to the break, we're asking that you call Congress. If you have a paper and pencil handy, jot down this number: 202-224-3121. Ask for your representative. It's the representatives who are voting today. And tell them that fast track should be voted down because it is bad for people, for democracy, for Earth, and for our living economies. Yes. 202-224-3121. Again, 202-224-3121. Now, please wait until the break, but make that your first order of business at the break. Thank you.
I'm not sure I understood. Just, you wanted us to hold this feeling, or what were you?
Yeah.
Okay. 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 Hold that. Okay. Thanks. Thank you, David. Thank you so much, David Korten. And you all have an opportunity to be with him at 12:45 for lunch will be served where he will be, and to explore further everything he was talking about and his books. This is the 20th anniversary of When Corporations Rule the World, but he also has a new book, Change the Story, Change the Future. And I also just wanted to say that my dear friend and colleague Christine, sitting next to me when I came back, still quite feeling a lot, Myrlin's poetry, said, wrote this to me, and I wanted to read it out loud. Isoke, who works with us in a lot of our programs as a host, a facilitator in ensuring that we are bringing our whole self to our work, said that, teaches us that emotion without expression is depression, which is why we should feel and express, not suppress. But then after the expression, we breathe deeply, over and over, integrating it, and use that, the power of that emotion, to fuel our work, and that will transform the world. So, let's go. Okay. And next, I'd like to introduce Adrienne Marie Brown, who I think exemplifies, in fact, what I just read from Christine. She's been a social justice facilitator for more than 2 decades, and she's a healer. I would describe her as a healer. Her work in somatics on the ground in places like Ferguson working, feeling, grief, rage, body healing. It really does exemplify the Martin Luther King quote about hate can't destroy hate, only love can do that. And she's an author of Octavia's Brood, and her book's available too. She'll be doing a book signing at lunch. And I love what she writes about. She's a sci-fi writer, and her reasoning is that it is our right and our responsibility to imagine the world that we want. Come on up, Adrienne. Oh, you're right, David. It's a little bright up here. All right. Hi, everyone. How are you? You're awesome? Okay, good. I'm going to try to keep it there. I wrote up my speech, and I want to just say for a vulnerability moment that I normally don't write up speeches. Normally, I like take this microphone, I walk all over the place, and I'm all fantastic. But I had an emergency surgery a couple months ago, and since then I've just been like giving in to the fact that I'm totally kind of overwhelmed. And it's all good overwhelm, but it means that I can't take the risk of just walking around being all fabulous, because who knows what would come out. And I wanted to be really intentional with y'all. So is that okay? All right. So first of all, thank you for the work that you're doing to bend the future towards justice and liberation. I'm really excited to be in this space with all of you. I've been to a BALLE gathering before, and every time I'm just like, oh, these are all the futurists in action. And it's cool to see you. I hope you see yourselves as very cool Matrix-style futurists in action. But if you don't, hopefully you will after this. I would call your work science fictional behavior, being concerned with the ways our actions and beliefs now, today, will shape the future and the tomorrows. You're excited by what you can create. You believe it is possible to create new worlds. You've been building it here the last few days and in your lives. You're believers. So am I. As Michelle mentioned, I'm the co-editor of an anthology of original science fiction from social justice movements called Octavia's Brood. It's named after Octavia Butler. Honors her. Have any of you read her work? Yeah? For the rest of you, Octavia Butler, just go read everything and then you'll be a better human. Our book just sold out of its first printing of 10,000 copies, and which is like very yay. For us, it's yay because we're like, I know about 2,000 people, you know like 2,000 people. So math-wise, that means it's gone beyond us, right? Which means it's very public that I believe in this new world building. But I've held that belief system for a long time, and I think it's because I was born to a Trekkie, meaning one who watches Star Trek obsessively. My father watched Star Trek in a way that now seems logical to me. He watched the way a black man from the Deep South, who was bringing up mixed-race children in a racist world, would watch a post-racist narrative, eyes wide, faith bubbling up. We all watched it together as his military career took our family from place to place. My parents intentionally took us away from the US for our early years. And I think they believed when we came back, things would be different. And when they weren't, they brought us back anyway, and they took us to Georgia. Have any of you been to Georgia? Any of y'all from Georgia? Okay, hey. I'm from South Carolina, but Georgia's harder. So I think what I experienced in Georgia, the casual and constant presence of white supremacy, the knee-jerk assessments of my intelligence and humanity, is one of the foundational catalysts for my study of science fiction and apocalypse and emergence and complexity. I thought in middle school, and I also think now, that this can't be all. No one will survive in this approach long term. The purpose of our species cannot be to constantly identify each other as other, build walls between ourselves, and engage in both formal and informal wars against each other's bodies, and build economies that could never serve a whole. I feel miraculous. It's confusing to feel so miraculous when so many people hate my skin and my history, but I still feel it. And I see the miraculousness in others. Even those who hate me have heartbeats, and I generally assume have people that they love. So why can't they love me? Should I love them anyway? How can I hold these massive contradictions? I started reading science fiction obsessively, looking for options, other worlds where I wasn't dismissed as an idealist or an inferior. On that path, I discovered Octavia Butler. Decades before my birth, she was working the same edges in her heart, pendulum swinging between curiosity, possibility, and hopelessness. If we can't articulate more viable futures and adapt, our future is hopeless. She understood that. She felt it. She wrote novels with young Black women protagonists, meeting aliens, surviving apocalypse, evolving into vampires, becoming telepathic networks, time traveling to save their slave owner ancestors. And woven throughout her work, there were two things. One, a coherent and visionary exploration of humanity. And two, emergent strategies for better humans. Like, how do we be better? I'll talk about emergent strategy more in a second. First of all, I want to say that my co-editor for Octavia's Brood and I, we don't call our work science fiction, even though that's what's on the cover of the book, because everyone's like, you can't call it something else, because no one's heard that term yet, so no one would buy it. But I'm going to tell you what we really call it. We really call it visionary fiction. We write fiction that disrupts the hero narrative concept that one person is going to save us. Often that one person is a white man. Often it's Matt Damon, who I love. I mean, he's a great guy. I like his water politics. But I don't think he's going to save me, you know? We write fiction. I keep telling, on the tour, I keep telling people, like, our stories are the kind of stories where Matt Damon couldn't be cast as the lead, you know? And then everyone's like, oh, okay, I get it. No, I totally understand that. We write fiction that explores change as a collective process, that explores change from the bottom up, fiction that centers those who have been currently marginalized, and not to be nice, which I think sometimes people are like, we should write a story with like a Black person in the lead because that would be nice. But we actually think that those who survive on the margins of the current economy tend to be the most experientially innovative. They're practicing survival-based efficiency, doing the most with the least. And that's an important skill to have on a planet whose resources are under assault by less marginalized people. In these ways, visionary fiction is constantly applying lessons from our past to our futures. It's neither utopian nor dystopian. I'm not interested in like living on a cloud and like playing a lute for eternity. I'm really interested in like continuously generating solutions and figuring out the next evolution. So for any of you lute players out there, it's all good. There's no judgment. Everybody has different ideas. Later you're going to have to come let me know if there's any lute players. I don't know if I've ever actually met one. So hard, realistic, and hopeful. That's what we're generating. Now we're here in Arizona, a land where the voting majority believes in aliens and where my safety is determined by the proximity of my passport. And the future is also unfurling here right in this room. So it's utopia, it's dystopia. Perspective is everything. As long as the future comes from imagination, there will be divergent paths that are moving in and out of alignment and in and out of conflict. Our ideas of right and wrong shift with time. Right now, it's clear to me that something is wrong if it hurts this planet. But if we don't claim the future, that sense of loyalty to Earth, of our environmentalism, could become an outdated concept. Kenny Bailey from the Design Studio for Innovation shared this recently on a panel called Black to the Future, that justice and rights, all these things that we take for granted even as we fight for them, they're not permanent. They could become old concepts. It's on us to determine whether they get held in the future. It affirmed to me that it's so important we get in the game, that we get dirty and experimental. How do we create and proliferate a compelling vision of a new economy that centers humans and the natural world over the accumulation of material? We embody, we learn, we release the idea of failure. It's all data. But first, we imagine. We are in an imagination battle right now. Claudia Rankine and Terry Marshall have both spoken of this. Trayvon Martin and Mike Brown and Renisha McBride and all of them are dead because in some white imagination, they were dangerous. And that imagination is so respected that those who would kill based on an imagined racialized fear of Black people are rarely held accountable. Imagination has people think that they can go from poverty to millionaire as part of a shared American dream.
Imagination turns brown bombers into terrorists and white bombers into mentally ill victims. Imagination gives us borders and gives us superiority and gives us race. We have to imagine beyond those fears. We have to ideate together. The poverty that results from our current system allows this imagining to be fed by the results of a scarcity economics. We must imagine new worlds that transition us from seeing black people as murderers or brown people as terrorists or aliens to ones that can see black and brown people as cultural and economic innovators and peers. Yes. So Black Lives Matter, which has issued a clarion call to us in this time, is brilliant on so many levels, one of which is that they created products to support their work almost immediately, making the look of the movement irresistible and undeniable. And I hope that all of you have your Black Lives Matter sweatshirts already or soon, because every race should be wearing them. They are now gathering stories from black people about what the world will look like when Black Lives Matter. This time travel exercise for the heart is ideation. What are the ideas that will liberate all of us? And the more of us who collaborate on that ideation, the more people who will be served by the worlds that result. And sci-fi is simply a way of practicing the future together. I suspect that that is what many of you in this room are up to, practicing a future economy together, building and practicing economic justice together, living into new stories. It is our right and responsibility to create a new world. You are all practicing that. And what we pay attention to grows. Have you heard that? I didn't make that up, but I don't quite know where it comes from. Anybody know where it comes from? It's many places, right? It's just like a universal thing. All right, I don't feel bad for not knowing. I'm gonna let it go. So what we pay attention to grows, and I'm thinking about how we grow what you all are imagining and creating into something that's large enough and solid enough for a tipping point of humans to cross over. Ursula Le Guin, one of my favorite science fiction writers, repping for Seattle, she recently said, "We live in capitalism. Its power seems inescapable, but so did the divine right of kings." She went on to say, "It's up to authors to spark the imagination of their readers and to help them envision alternatives to how to live." I agree with her. We must make an alternative economic future, as Tony Cade Bambara taught us, irresistible. That was our goal with the Octavia's Brood Anthology, to have a collection of compelling and irresistible stories. But I think you all are amongst the protagonists of what might be called these great turning stories, these change stories, these new economic stories. Do you think that's true? Are you like ready to be the heroes and sheroes of the future? All right. And they rose, I guess, in a new generation. Okay. So also, I want to say that I think it's really healing behavior. I think to look at something so broken as our current economy and our current structure of society and to see it whole and to imagine something that could serve everyone is actually a healing activity. So I am a healer. That's how I work as a healer, is I just look at the body that I'm working with and that I'm holding between my hands and I imagine wholeness. And I let wholeness kind of flow through my system into that body. And I think that's what you're doing too. And I'm grateful that you're doing it. And I want to say thank you over and over again a million times. I also want to say that I think this is in part because of you practicing what I've been calling emergent strategies. So now is where I go on the science nerd part of my story. And that's hopefully a good ride for y'all. I think science is so cool now. I didn't think that when I was a kid at all. But now I think it's awesome. Do any of you know what emergence is? You're all like emergence practitioners. All right, so for those who don't know, emergence is the way complex patterns and systems arise out of relatively simple interactions. Birds flocking, schools of fish in motion, the way mushrooms grow underground. Mushrooms are my favorite thing. I recently got gifted a little mushroom as a pet because I talk so lovingly about mushrooms and someone said, "You should have this lion's mane mushroom to carry with you." My mentor, Grace Lee Boggs, who is about to turn 100 years old in Detroit, she is so brilliant, and she first raised this concept with us in Detroit after reading Margaret Wheatley's work about biomimicry and mycelium magic. Grace started asking us what our movements would look like if we focused on critical connections instead of critical mass. We need each other. And I love the idea, it's a good idea, I love the idea of shifting from mile-wide, inch-deep movements to inch-wide, deep, mile-deep movements that schism the existing paradigm. Strategy is just a military term that means a plan of action towards a goal. We currently use it to mean something's good or bad, but it's actually not that discerning. Really horrible plans can be pitched as strategic. We have to be more precise, so emergent strategies are ways for humans to practice complexity and grow the future through relatively simple interactions. This is what made sense to me when I was trying to explain the kind of leadership in Octavia Butler's books. It wasn't just that it was black and female and young leaders, or perhaps it was because of all of those things, but who leads matters. But what I noticed is that her leaders were adaptive. They rode change like dolphins or surfers ride the ocean. They were adaptive but also intentional, like birds migrating south who know how to get where they're going even when a storm knocks them off 100 miles. I just came from supporting a meeting that Naomi Klein called in Canada to set an intention to build a clean energy economy in that nation. And I was so moved by their work to build a shared intention. That's radical imagination. Oh, what does it say? Oh, good, I'm doing great. Just so y'all know, don't be worried, I'm going great. So Octavia's protagonists were also interdependent and often polyamorous because the personal is political, because pleasure evokes change perhaps more than shame. And I think this is something that our movements are going to learn in an interesting way. It's rather than being like, you're such a horrible racist, it's more like, how can we turn this into, oh, I can't take it there. Okay, so you'll get it later if you don't have it now. But right now there is an effort called BOLD, Black Organizing for Leadership and Dignity, and it's cultivating a safe space for black vulnerability and mutual support of leaders. And it's countering the usual model of leader isolation. We all need a place where we can weep and be held and feel our feelings and figure out how those feelings can direct our next evolution. And what amazes me is that in this space of such constant 28 hours black trauma, we get together and we don't weep, we celebrate, and we love on each other, and we laugh, and we find the pleasure of community and interdependence with each other. It feels good to be together. And I think y'all are experiencing this too. When you find your tribe, your flock, your people, you're like, yes, how do I grow this, right? Octavia's leaders were also decentralized, and they were generative. And resilience came from their decentralization that no one person held the power, which I think is a major lesson from the civil rights movement. Ferguson recently showed us the power of individuals willing to act without a single leader. And their leaderful example is now inspiring others to stand up in real time, offline and online, to change legislation and perception. Ferguson and other movements were also fractal, practicing at a small scale what we most want to see at the universal level. No more growth before experience. There's a group in New Orleans called the Wild Seeds that's doing this fractal work. It's a women of color body practicing pop-up galleries and stores where they put forward black beauty, black fantastic, black creativity as their counter to racism. And I think it's a beautiful counter. Like, what are we creating and generating? And how do we then sustain ourselves on our radical creativity rather than our radical victimhood? Then rather than narrowing into one path forward, Octavia's leaders were creating more and more possibilities. That's what I see here. Not one perfect path or one single organization or business, but an abundance of futures, of ways to manage resources together and be brilliant together. So I have become obsessed with how we can be movements like flocks of birds, underground power like that massive mushroom under Oregon, how we can be the seashell representation of a galactic vision for economic justice. I invite you to join me in writing ourselves into the future, naming the principles of total transformation, building an economy in which Black lives matter because every single life and all that supports life matter. Let us practice in every possible way the world we want to see. I love y'all.
Yes, Detroit. Yes, Detroit. I am on an emotional roller coaster here. I am like, that's amazing. amazing. That was genius. That is, God, that was good. Wasn't that so good? That was genius. Adrienne. Yes, God, yes, 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 yes to that. Yes, yes, yes to that. God, I don't know what else to say. Yes, can I hear a yes? Yes to that, yes to that. God, genius. So well said. We will watch that lots of times. We're going to watch your videotape in the mornings. Do we have videotapes anymore? I don't even know. So many things you said. This is what we are about, too, cultivating the emergence of a new economy and how you said it. And even, I have to just say, the fellowship, that term you used, you said polyamory. The fellowship came up with a term called bollyamory because it's like we all love each other so much. Yeah, we love each other. Adrienne, that was so good. Thank you so much. So now I am going to do this next introduction in as short amount of time as possible because I know that you want to hear from him much more than you want to hear from me. I get to introduce Van Jones, who, Van, who we knew when and who knew us when. Van, who was on the board of the Social Venture Network when BALLE was born, when it was birthed out of the Social Venture Network. He voted to make us happen. And he has been with us and spoke to us and inspired us, and we've gone home and we've built green jobs and we've built the kinds of, how do we get people who are had not had the same access to opportunity into jobs that are restorative for our planet. We've been inspired by him. He's come back. He spoke, but it's been a while since he's been here with us. So I want to say a little bit about him. He is himself a social entrepreneur, a very, very successful one. He has built five long-lasting social enterprises that are still going. You know, some of us have started things that are not still going. He's started lots of things that are still here and alive, including things like Green for All, the Ella Baker Center for Human Rights, Dream Corps. Exactly. And, we know him now from advising the White House, being part of the White House, being on CNN. I'll just say two more things about him, two more accolades. I did want to name. One is that he is Time Magazine has named him one of the 100 most influential people on the whole planet. And Fast Company magazine, I love this one. Fast Company magazine said he's going to, you know, really think and hear, take in what he has to say, because they say he's one of the 12 most creative minds on earth. Van Jones.
Who said that? Oh, Detroit, okay. Yeah. Good to see you, sister. First of all, let's hear it again for Adrienne. That was extraordinary. And I always love hearing the gospel according to Brother David Korten, so give him another round of applause. That was equally extraordinary. I also just want to say how good it is to be here. I see Judy Wicks, who first came to the Social Venture Network board meeting. I think, Pam, you were there with this crazy idea. And here it is. So give Judy and Pam and everybody, you know, this is a, you can't take this stuff for granted. Leadership, it matters. You know, people need a home. People need a place to be. And Judy saw that folks didn't have that. And so here we are. I also want to thank and acknowledge my friend Allie Starr. Some of you guys may know her, some of you may not. We've been together for about 20 years. The Ella Baker Center, which got mentioned, which has closed 5 youth prisons. Has cut, Cal, you can clap for that. We cut California's youth prison population by 80%, stopped them from building the super jail. Allie was a part of that. Let me just brag on her a little bit more. Then in the floodwaters of Katrina, Allie and I were in the first meeting that gave rise to something called colorofchange.org, which is now the biggest and fastest growing African-American civil rights organization on earth. You heard about Trayvon Martin because of Color of Change. We also built something called Green for All together, which passed the Green Jobs Act, got about $500 million of job training money down to the hood, and created about 10,000 green jobs across the country right now today, which people don't hear about. So just thank my friend Allie Starr. She's been just an extraordinary. Please stand up. Please stand up. Thank my friend Allie Starr. She doesn't, you know, a lot of times, you know, it's hopefully not big news to people, but sometimes it seems like the women do a lot of work. And the guys give a lot of speeches. So I just want to honor people like, you know, Jody Evans and Allie and all the people who are in front of and behind the scenes making stuff happen. And I also want to thank all of you individually. This is not Bally's moment. I'm always going to be honest with you. Bally's moment is coming. And it's coming fast. This level of convergence, which everybody's all excited about, is the very beginning of a process that's about to accelerate very rapidly. You guys are about to experience, both organizationally and from a movement perspective, thanks to the kinds of ideas that Adrienne is talking about, the rapid stitching together of possibilities, which is going to suck. Because we don't know how to do that. And so there are going to be problems. There's going to be misunderstandings. There's going to be confusion. There's going to be tears, and not all of them beautiful tears like Michelle's. So there's no point. We're all grown folks, and most of us are friends. So there's no point in me getting up here and just giving you a bunch of happy talk. I want us to do well. And I want to tell a little story about one of my great heroes. And then I want to talk about what I see from a very specific African-American, male, heterosexual, middle class, upper middle class perspective. But I hope that it's useful. There's an African revolutionary named Samora Machel, who most people don't talk about. Somebody from Detroit, like, oh, he going there. I told you, I'm not messing around. She like, seatbelt. I'm gonna be gentle. Samora Machel, beautiful brother, African revolutionary in Mozambique. Fighting against the Portuguese in the 1870s. Oh, no, I'm sorry. The 1970s. There was still colonialism. European boots on the ground, machine guns, napalm, colonialism in the 1970s in Africa. Before you even deal with South Africa, you still had European powers militarily occupying, brutalizing folks. So people think, why do you guys keep talking about race? That was 1,000 years ago, man. My God. Are you going to play the race card again? Yeah, I am. I'm a 9th generation American. I'm the first person in my family that was born with all my rights. I'm a 9th generation American. My mother was born in segregation. My father was born in segregation. My mother and father were married under segregation. My cousin Kenya was born in 65 before they signed the Voting Rights Act. She wasn't born with all her rights. I'm the first person in my family born in 68, born with all my rights. So when people talk about 1,000 years ago, I say, no, you're talking about my mother. My mother, my father. So, Samora Machel in the 70s was trying to get free and helping his people get free. So he sent word to his allies in Europe and said, hey, we're down here, we're fighting the Portuguese, please stand with us. And they sent a benefactor sent a letter, and Samora Michelle was very excited, and the letter had a check in it. And he said, what's the words on the check? Well, first the interpreter said, well, look at the number on the check. Well, the number is very big. The number makes me very happy. With the numbers, I can buy food. With the numbers, I can buy medicine. With the numbers, I can buy weapons. With the numbers, I can do a lot. I know there's a lot of money, but what are the words? Charitable contribution. Charitable contribution. Samora said, send it back. Send it back. And he communicated back something that has been become a central part of African revolutionary theory and history and practice. He said, I wrote to you seeking solidarity. He said, I wrote to you seeking solidarity. Solidarity is not charity. He said, solidarity is an act of mutual aid between two forces seeking the same objective. See? Solidarity is not charity. It's an act of mutual aid between two forces seeking the same objective. That is a very different model than diversity. That's a very different model than inclusion for nicety's sake. It's saying there's a future that we want to build, there's a future worth fighting for, and I can't get there without you. And you can't get there without me. And based on your assets, based on who you are, based on your gifts, based on your genius, based on your knowledge, based on what you were born to do and be. If you put that on the table and I put mine on the table and she puts hers and he puts his and they put theys, is that right? Okay. A better world's possible. That central insight, which is in the mouths and the hearts of so many different leaders and so many different bodies and so many different genders and so many different histories, but that central insight that everybody counts and everybody matters and we're better together is the breakthrough insight. It's the opposite of the colonial model that David was talking about. It's literally its inversion. The colonizer said, look at this continent. I can put a price tag on everything here. These aren't my sister and brother species. These are pelts. These are pelts that I can kill and skin and sell. The colonizer said, no. You can't chop down all these trees. You can't dam up all these rivers. You can't kill all our sister and brother species out of season, out of rhythm, out of cycle. This is all sacred. The colonizer said, no, that's not a tree, that's timber. I can put a price tag on everything, including you. Healing from 500 years of that is not something that happens in a day. Takes about a millennium. And we're early in the process. So among friends, speaking truthfully helps. So let me just speak truthfully for a little bit. We're all friends. The era, the Obama era, of black silence on issues that critically matter to us is over. I'm going to say it again. The Obama era of black silence on issues that critically matter to us is over. If you haven't watched television recently, you should. You will notice. It's over. Black Lives Matter was not a 2008 Obama slogan. In fact, the opposite. Every other community we could and should talk about, but not the black community. It was okay as it should have been okay and needs to be okay and will be okay and will be more okay to talk about the Latino community, the immigrant rights community, and the incredible suffering and pain that was spoken to so beautifully by the poet earlier. Give him a round of applause. That struggle has to be elevated even more. It was okay to talk about climate change. It was okay to talk about the incredible oppression and the liberatory journey of our lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender brothers and sisters. We could talk about those, but when you said black, everybody got uncomfortable. And this president that I love trained us into don't talk about that. He said, just we're going to talk about Obamacare, don't mention that it might disproportionately help you, just shut up and hope it helps you. We're not going to accept trickle-down economics, and we're not going to accept trickle-down justice. Trickle-down justice doesn't work. It hasn't worked. The idea you just let politics happen and you're the only person who's hurting that can't holler, and somehow that's going to work out for you, has been proven now in practice that it doesn't. Where is the black community right now? If we're going to have a rainbow coalition, let's look at every stripe. Where is the black community right now? We're in free fall. We're in free fall. The United States has 25% of the world's population, 5% of the greenhouse gases, 5% of the world's prisoners. A little country, 5%. 25% of the greenhouse gases from us, throwaway planet. 25% of the world's prisoners from us, throwaway people. 1 out of 4 of every, if you're a Martian, 1 out of every 4 human beings locked up in chains anywhere on planet Earth are locked up right here in the land of the free, home of the brave. Vast majority, black, brown, overwhelmingly poor, mostly for so-called nonviolent drug offenses. I just want to say very clearly, I believe we got some nonviolent drug offenders up in here. Run! Call the police! Don't raise your hand. I mean, there's a video camera here. So. About to get some testimonials. Country clubs, yacht clubs, Wall Street, Ivy League campuses. That's where the drugs are being done. And it doesn't shock anybody here that everybody here knows that there's never going to be police descending on the campus at Yale and kicking in the door skull and bones and dragging those kids out in their underwear and shooting them if they talk back, ever. And you know it, but you accept it and I accept it. We live in this and pretend that race doesn't matter and that anybody who raises it is just playing a race card. And you live in it every day. We have a seamless web of violence directed from the government I love against poor brown people. We have to talk about it. Inside the U.S. border, it looks like mass incarceration and police brutality, and that is symbolized mainly by the violence done to what they now call black bodies. We used to just call it us. Yeah. Now in the academy, I say black bodies. We say they beaten on us. But that's just a part of it. Inside the U.S. border, police violence, mass incarceration, on terms that you know are not fairly distributed, at the U.S. border, detention and deportations, mainly symbolized by the plight of Latinos, beyond the U.S. border, militarization of our relationship with Persian, Arab, and Muslim countries. Poor brown people being brutalized by the government and the country that we love. And a hidden epidemic of solitary confinement inside of the prisons. Concentrated prisons inside of prisons, heaping damage on damage, pain on pain, so that people are now, you're worried about people shooting, brothers shooting each other on the street corner, or getting shot by cops. Brothers are now taking their own lives, and sisters too, because they can't deal with 1 year, 2 year, 3 years of solitary confinement waiting for a trial. The brother killed himself 3 years, Rikers Island, 3 years waiting for a trial over a book bag. Teenager, over a book bag, stolen book bag, 3 years in the hole in the United States. We can't be quiet no more. And we can't talk about it in racially neutral and racially comfortable terms, because it's not happening in racially neutral, racially comfortable ways. At some point, we have to deal with reality. So, you know, I've done what I tend to do. Done what you guys do. Started an initiative, started an organization, started a campaign. You know, that's what we do. I think it's important that some of the things that people like me and Allie have been able to build get recognized. Because it's hard to build the kind of stuff that we build in Oakland. I also think it's not enough. And that's why we have to reach out to each other now. Have a whole long speech about the Dream Corps and all our great initiatives and everything that we're doing, but I'm not going to share that with you for one reason. She said I can't because I only got 5 minutes. So, but it's amazing stuff. Just Cliff Notes version. It's amazing stuff. We got this thing called the Dream Corps. Kind of like the Marine Corps, but more fabulous. See? I'm influenced. The Dream Corps. We think the future's worth fighting for. So we have a campaign called Cut 50, hashtag Cut 50. It's a campaign to cut the U.S. prison population in half over the next 10 years. And it can be done. It can be done. And when Adrienne talks about critical connections, not just critical mass, on the left on our campaign, we have everybody you would expect us to have. We had a big summit in Washington, D.C., bipartisan summit. We had Cory Booker, who was there. He was brilliant. We had the ACLU. We had all of that. But on the right, Newt Gingrich, Alec, the people we fight all the time who brought us Stand Your Ground, and Mark Holden from Koch Industries in the room. 10 congresspeople, both parties in the room. Eric Holder, while he was still attorney general, in the room. President Obama sent a video. We thought we would have about 100 people. Newt Gingrich and I are on CNN together. We made a friendship on this issue. He said, Republicans know it's a crime. They know that building a big, massive, failed government bureaucracy that gets bigger every year, the worst job it does, is not conservative and not right. But we don't know how to talk about it. So I said, Newt, you know, I love you, but we can't just talk in private. right? And he said, you're right, let's bring this conversation publicly. We thought we'd have 100 people. We thought we'd have an hour of their time. We had 700 people. We spent 8 hours together. Had it not been for that plane that crashed in France, it'd have been lead story, but you know, we got wiped out by that. But I want you to know something. About halfway through that summit, in the middle of Washington, D.C., and all the dysfunction, if you close your eyes, you can tell the Democrats from the Republicans. Liberty and justice for all means something to people. Don't forget that. Conservatives talk a lot about liberty, individual rights, limited government. That is the opposite of mass incarceration in an incarceration industry. Liberals talk a lot about justice, social justice, racial justice, et cetera. That's the opposite of what we're doing. So both sides, if you want to talk about sides, have our core principles being violated every day by this mass incarceration industry. And it has to be spoken about in those terms. My concern as we move forward is that we have to strike that balance between real enthusiasm and hope and the desire for us to have unity and the willingness to understand we have to earn it. We have to work for it. We have to struggle. It's not just unity, 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 or struggle, struggle, struggle. It's unity, and then it's struggle to get to higher unity. And then you struggle to get to higher unity. And we have too many people who just want to struggle all the time and never have any unity. They're not mostly here. That's why you have this conference. But you have people who just want to have the unity and the feel good and don't want to have any tough conversations. It doesn't work. And so my great hope for BALLE, and I didn't see it anywhere near as clearly as Pam and Judy saw it at the time, but my great hope for BALLE is that the mix is right. You have enough hurt and enough hope. You have enough frustration, but also enough inspiration. And that you have the right mix of people so that the future has a place to land and to live. And we're going to screw it up a lot. We're going to hurt each other's feelings. I've probably hurt somebody's feeling today. You know, don't talk to me about it on Twitter. You can just come up here later. But this organization gives me hope. It gives me so much hope. And the people who are supporting financially, I hope you're proud. Because if it's going to get done, it's going to get done by people in this room and people like this. And we're going to be in a difficult season. There's going to be a tough election process. And there will be times where it's going to feel like it's completely impossible for this country and this community to come back together. It will. It will. We'll push through this and it will. And when it comes back together, it's going to be because we had one or two networks like this that had a shared intention to build an economy that works for everybody and where everybody can work and where we honor the idea of liberty and justice for all. Thank you very much.
Van Jones is a miracle. Thank you so much. I wish that for us too. I wish us enough hurt and enough hope and enough unity and enough struggle. Thank you, Van, for saying this is all sacred. Thank you for saying enough hurt, enough hope, enough unity, enough struggle. Thank you. So we have another full day together after this.
Because you're professionals now and you went through yesterday and found your way around, we made it tighter so you have less time. You're trained. You know how to get to your next place. You have 25 minutes to get from here to there. And we did one little exciting switcheroo. The end of the day, you're not going to meet here for the closing session. You're going to be in the Crescent Ballroom. So one new obstacle, one new challenge, because you're professional. I'm also supposed to say that there's still room on the post-conference tours tomorrow in Phoenix. They're going to be awesome. And apparently there's also wine tasting on those tours. And you all... No, for sure there's going to be wine. It's not like maybe, apparently there could be, possibly. No, there's going to be wine. It's a wine tour, in fact. You also have reusable things around your necks that are called lanyards. I don't know why they're called lanyards. But everywhere you go, if you leave any time early, there's going to be boxes at the end of every session where you can put them. So please put them there. And Kimber here from Arizona said, she's had so many people come up to her and say, my mind is completely changed about Phoenix. I actually had really different impressions than I'm experiencing here. And there are a lot of people who've been volunteering their time to help you see that differently, like street ambassadors volunteering their time because they want you to see what they see. And so she would love to be able to share with them what you've seen. And her email is Kimber, K-I-M-B-E-R, at localfirstaz.com. If you just send her like a sentence, she'd like to compile some testimonials that help them, these volunteers who are trying to show the best of what's here, to feel that. So Kimber at localfirstaz.com. And the final thing I need to say is, unfortunately, the phone number to Congress was one number off. So write this down instead. Call Congress at 202-225-3121, 202-225-3121. You can call on your walk over right now. You got to get there in 25 minutes because we're going to start on time. And we're about to talk about how does politically organizing power meet a new economy. We're going to be talking about what really works to determinedly invest for opportunity in communities that have faced historic and current racism and oppression. We're going to be talking about innovation for good, building the entrepreneurial ecosystems that allow us to create what we need for our futures. And we're going to talk about how we cultivate within ourselves the leadership capacity to meet what we need to for tomorrow. So you're not going to want to miss. Thank you.